Paul is the best friend you didn't even know you needed, and I'm going to challenge you to play a game of word association. That's what's coming up on this episode of Cultivate. All right, well, welcome back. It's another week, another episode of Cultivate, another chance to begin preparing the soil of our hearts for God's truth, to find a good resting place there, to put down roots and to bear fruit in our lives. We're getting back into Ephesians, and we're actually starting at chapter 3 this week. We're going to be in chapter 3, verses 1 through 13, and I'll go ahead and read it for us so we can have it fresh in our minds as we're thinking about it throughout the week. Here it is. Let me pull it up on the screen. Okay, here we go. Ephesians chapter 3, verses 1 through 13. For this reason, I, Paul, the prisoner of Christ Jesus, on behalf of you Gentiles, you have heard, haven't you, about the administration of God's grace that he gave you, gave to me for you? The mystery was made known to me by revelation, as I have briefly written above. By reading this, you are able to understand my insight about the mystery of the Messiah. This was not made known to people in other generations, as it is now revealed to his holy apostles and prophets by the Spirit. The Gentiles are co-heirs, members of the same body, and partners of the promise in Christ Jesus through the gospel. I was made a servant of this gospel by the gift of God's grace that was given to me by the working of his power. This grace was given to me, the least of all the saints, to proclaim to the Gentiles the incalculable riches of the Messiah and to shed light for all about the administration of the mystery hidden for ages in God who created all things. This is so God's multifaceted wisdom may now be made known through the church to the rulers and authorities in the heavens. This is according to his eternal purpose accomplished in the Messiah, Jesus our Lord. In him, we have boldness and confident access through faith in him. So then I ask you not to be discouraged over my afflictions on your behalf, for they are for your glory. That's our scripture, and I'm so excited to get into studying this word with you. I just think it's a chance for us to really dig deep in. Abby, I told you I'm recording. Don't interrupt. No, I'm in the middle of something. Dad, what?
Something in your teeth.
Something in my. There's some. What? Okay, so, we're back. No worries, we'll just move. Have you ever had a friend who's done that, who's called you out on something about something that was helpful for you? Like something that's super embarrassing, like maybe, you know, your zipper's down or something and you didn't know what was going on, but somebody does you a favor and calls it out and tells you about it. I almost think that's kind of what we get here from Paul. You know, he's been given this good news. He's been given this message. He has been told this mystery. And he's going to be a good friend, a good companion to share this journey with. Somebody who sees something that's going wrong in other people's lives and actually does something about it, actually shares the good news with them, something they needed to hear but haven't heard yet. Paul's saying, I recognize your struggle because I've experienced myself. Let me help you discover a hope. I see something in you that's going wrong, and I recognize it because I've experienced it myself. Let me help you discover a hope that will set you free. That's the motivation behind Paul's passion. It's what God used in him so he could become such an incredible influence to the church throughout history. So when we read this section of Paul in Ephesians chapter 3, really what he's saying is, I've been given a hope. And I think it's going to help you. I see an area in your life where it will help you. Let me share it to you. Let me bring it to you. Let me share it to you, church. In fact, speaking of church, there's something else that Paul mentions here that I wanted to address this week and just kind of share with you and get you thinking about this week. Have you ever played a game of word association where you say something and then, you say the first word that kind of pops into your mind? Somebody will say something to you and you just say the first word that pops into your mind. I thought we'd play this a little bit here. I already played this with one of my daughters, and we'll just see kind of what her answers are and see how they equate to your answer. The first word here, and I just want you to just in your own head or wherever you are, just kind of see what word associates with that. The first one is the word hot. And we'll see what we have here. Hot. Oh, yeah. Pizza. Hot. Pizza. Okay. Pretty good. Okay. I don't know what word you came up with. Let's keep going. The next one I have here is, what if I was to say to you the word tasty? What's the first word that pops into your head? First word for my daughter, of course, was pizza. And the last word I have here, which we probably don't even need to know, I wrote lunch. And I guess, what do you think the word here is? Of course, pizza. So I guess I know what we're doing for our meal later today. But maybe if you've ever played a game of word association like that, maybe sometimes it shows a little bit about where your mind is, right? What's kind of already present in your thinking, and your natural inclination is to go there. What if I was to say the word church to you? I'm sure in our lives we could fill in any number of answers, any number of experiences, or any number of knee-jerk reactions of what the church is known for in our lives, of what words come immediately to mind when you hear church. How about this one, though? How about this be the word that we strive for to be associated with church? How about this word, hope? Hope. When Paul talks about the church here in Ephesians, he tells us what it should be known for, what it should be notorious for, making the mystery of the gospel known to the world. The church should be known to be agents of hope. Like these days, on the rare occasion when the sun comes out here in Vermont, and it just feels like such a beautiful moment, right? This golden kind of ray just breaking through the dark and kind of gloomy clouds, and it just shines down, and it just brings with it this feeling of life, this feeling of maybe there's something good coming in the future, you know? Such a beautiful idea. And I wonder, maybe that's what the church should be known for. Let's be that golden ray of hope in the lives of people around us. Let's look for ways we can shine the hope of Jesus into our own lives and the way we can do that in the lives of others this week. Let's let the church be known for hope. That's what we got this week for Cultivate. And once again, I want to encourage you to prepare the soil of your heart so that the Lord can begin a work in you. I've been really enjoying this series, and I'm looking forward to what's coming up next week. Until then, keep up that time in the Word. We'll see you later.